And welcome back to the Jason Show, Home Edition. I got to tell you, I've been doing TV so long that I remember interviewing our next guest when he was at Minnetonka High School, winning awards and getting a lot of attention when I did The Buzz on Channel 9. Well, now he is a Broadway star. He's been on this network and the Rocky Horror Picture Show Live. He's back home. He's back here in Minnesota. Please welcome Minnesota native and good guy all around, Ryan McCartan. Hello, Ryan.
Hey, thanks for having me. An intro.
Seriously, it was funny. I have followed your career, and Lord knows I don't expect you to remember this, but I remember, I think you won the award, or I can't remember why you were specifically on The Buzz, but I remember sitting there on the couch with you, the Spotlight Award, and I remember sitting on the couch with Alex, and you got up after the interview, and I looked at Alex, my co-anchor, and said, he's going to make it. Like, out of all, you know, because everyone, you know, there's a lot of people that have dreams of making it. But I said, that guy, we're going to see in a playbill in like 5 years. And you did it. Do you take a moment to wrap your head around that, Ryan, that you started at Minnetonka High School and then you did and you do? Your name is in playbill. I mean.
Yeah. That is certainly not lost on me. I mean, I think that I'm always putting my future hopes in context of my past experiences. And frankly, I need to say, you know, I think that I'm pretty good. I'm pretty proud of what I do. But honestly, the only reason that I think I have any success at all is because I'm smart enough to surround myself with truly exceptional people. And that has been the case for my entire life. And that comes from good parenting. That comes from good teachers. That comes from just a good community all around. People pointing me in the right direction and supporting me with a community of people who are truly exceptional, truly just geniuses. My friends and coworkers and colleagues all across the board, all down the line. And so some of their genius rubs off on me, and I'm really fortunate for that.
Probably on the top of that list, and you know, we have our fair share of guests from Minnetonka High School. I try, whether it's on the radio show or this show, to shine a light on them because they're exceptional what they do. What is it about Minnetonka High School, Ryan, that, I mean, year after year, as classes come in class, what is it about that program that sets it apart?
Geez, how much time do you have?
We have as much time. It's the apocalypse, Ryan. We can do a 2-hour special on this.
All right, then. Well, I mean, I think in the interest of total candor, first and foremost, we have the support of the community, both kind of the emotional, intellectual support, but also the financial support. There are people who think that the arts are worth investing in, an investment that I wholeheartedly agree with, but sadly an investment that is not matched in many communities all across our country and world. And when you have a community that has, you know, patrons of the arts willing to support it, both by putting their butts in seats, but also by putting their dollars into the program, that makes a huge difference because you have the financial support to get the tools you need to make something really spectacular happen. But to that end, that's not enough. It's not enough to just put on an amazing show. And the thing that I think is really fantastic between Kent Knutson and Trent Boyum and all of the people who have worked with the Minnetonka Theater Program is that they understand that two things are happening simultaneously. They are creating theater, they're creating art, that's extremely important, but they're also educating students. They are empowering students with educational tools, with artistic tools that they can carry forward in the future. They are imbuing them with a sense of passion and importance. And that comes through in the work that the students do, that what they are doing matters. And frankly, you know, theater to me was a hobby until I went to Minnetonka High School. And I had worked professionally before I had gone to Minnetonka, but you know, you mentioned it was Spotlight and things of that nature. I remember when I won my first Spotlight Award and I was like, wait, this is something that's worth an accolade? This is something that's worth recognition? That was news to me. The arts were frilly. The arts were, you know, inconsequential, non-substantial to me. And then all of a sudden they were substantiated, they were made serious. And I thought to myself, wait, this could be an actual career. That happened not just because of the spectacular art that was being made, but because of the care and instruction that was coming from the teachers. And I think that's really, really crucial.
And rare. I mean, it's yeah. And it's something, it's something that I think we here in the Twin Cities need to not take it, not to take for granted, and look at it as a wonderful jewel that we have here.
Absolutely. Yeah, I mean, to your point, it's rare to have both at once. I mentioned the support of the community, both financially and otherwise, and then the importance of the instruction and things of that nature. To have the synthesis of those two at the same time is extremely rare and extremely important and should be protected at all costs.
I told you we had a lot of time. We're going to take a break, everyone. When we come back, Ryan was cast in Frozen on Broadway, and then, well, the apocalypse happened. So we're going to talk about that. We're going to talk about his career and how he stays positive. Ryan's on Instagram, and how he stays positive when it's really hard sometimes to focus on the good. That and more when we come back. Back in a moment. And welcome back. Joined once again by our friend Ryan McCartan, Broadway star, Minnesota native. Ryan, I was, okay, so I said in the tease leading up to this, you've done Heathers off Broadway. You did Wicked on Broadway at the Gershwin. We'll talk about Rocky Horror that was right here on this network. But you were cast as Hans in Frozen. How long were you on stage? And talk about that moment. You were there when basically the cliche, the lights went out on Broadway. Walk me through it. What was that like?
Yeah, I mean, it was wild. Circumstantially, everything that you described is correct, but then you compound it with another factor, which is that Disney essentially rebooted Frozen on Broadway. We had a very intensive rehearsal process as myself, Ellen Marlowe, Mackenzie Kurtz, and Sierra Renee were all new cast members. They wanted to, you know, they added a new song, a duet for the girls. They added new staging elements and things of that nature, some special effects, things like that. And so we had a whole new tech process. The show was kind of restructured and then released to a brand new audience of very excited people, some who were coming for the first time, some who had already seen it, who were so eager to see it again. So you have all of that happening. The rehearsal process was grueling. It was amazing, but it was intense. It was about a month. And then we hit the stage for about 3.5 years. And then news from on high came down that Broadway was shuttering its doors. And now keep in mind, Broadway has shut down before. There was the 01 strike in, I believe, 2007, and that lasted, you know, 14, 17 days, something like that. So this has happened, but for a very brief period of time. And when news of COVID-19 started spreading, we all assumed that perhaps just as a safety measure, as in terms of liability and things of that nature, that we would maybe shut down for a week or two. You know, news has just come down from the Broadway League that Broadway shows are shut down until September 6th. This is just a month after we were told this is just a brief 4-week thing. So it's truly insane. This has never happened in the history of Broadway ever. And to be a part of that is illuminating and, I guess, special if you have to look for a silver lining. But it's also crazy. Yeah. I mean, you know, kind of one of the only stable jobs in the entertainment business is landing a show like Frozen, which is, you know, subsidized by Disney Theatrical Group, has all the money in the world and is not going to close anytime soon. That's kind of like the only stability that an actor like me gets. And for that to be given and then just ripped away by a circumstance like this is, I mean, it's wild, but it does two things. One, it reminds us, you know, don't make plans because yeah. they're always bound to change. But it also, I feel uniquely qualified to weather this storm because as an actor, I go from employed to unemployed all the time.
Yeah.
So, you know, I'm hunkering down. I'm finding creative ways to make money and keep myself engaged in artistic creation and things of that nature. And that's all that I can really do in this time.
In our remaining minutes, I want to talk about because I find, you know, sometimes it's so vapid, the world of social media and just devoid of, well, any type of constructive conversation or, but I find your social media a nice little respite in that. You're thoughtful. It's not just pictures of you staring at yourself in the mirror. You know, and you've been doing these apocalypse diaries. We're taking a look at your Insta right now. One of them that struck me was you were very forthcoming and very real. And I found this refreshing. And I try to do it here on the show. You were very real about trying to find some good because you're really down on this particular day. How are you trying to keep a balance? Are you keeping a lid on how much news you consume? How do you do that? How are you trying to stay positive in this nutter butter time?
I appreciate you saying all that. Really quickly before I answer your question, I just want to say, you know, my Instagram used to be a lot of pictures of myself staring at myself in the mirror. I don't want you to give me too much credit because, listen, fame is like a drug. It is very addictive, and it's hard to realize that you are addicted. And I was addicted. And it took me a lot of self-work to realize that social media, it's like a scythe. It's either a weapon or a tool. It depends on how you wield it and who's wielding it in the first place. And, you know, when it came to this time in particular, but also just in general, you know, I have mild anxiety. I have mild depression. I you know, was abused as a child. There's a lot of things that have happened to me that I feel it's really important that I speak out about to give people the sense, A, that if it's Mr. Rogers said this, if it's mentionable, it's manageable. I think that's really important. But also, you know, people aren't alone. And when it came to this, I felt this desperate need, as I think many people do, to participate in the process of making a change, to participate in the process of making a difference, to show up and say what needs to be said in any way, shape, or form. And I try my hardest to always say when I make these videos, this is just my opinion, and if you disagree, I want you to disagree, and I want you to tell me why you disagree. I want to participate in a discourse. We don't have a healthy dialogue in this world anymore, and I think it's a darn shame because if you can communicate about it, you realize that there is so much more that we have in common than what divides us. But if you show up to a conversation deciding preemptively that it's going to be an argument, you've already lost. And so I try to imbue that sense of community in the content that I create. And then to answer your question about finding a balance and you know, remaining optimistic, I think first and foremost, it's about acceptance. Adaptation cannot come until acceptance is achieved, and one must accept that these times are very difficult. One must accept that consciously or subconsciously, all of us are experiencing trauma and grief, that grief has stages and that those stages can show up at any time. So to empower people to accept and not wrestle with the anger or the depression or the bargaining that they might be experiencing in this time, and that it is in fact normal to be going through grief in a global pandemic. So that's a big thing that I focus on, is accepting the feelings that I feel instead of judging them, because with judgment just comes more anxiety, and none of us need that.
No.
And then, you know, finally, I think that just like I said before, participating in the process of making a difference, participating in something, showing up to something, holding yourself accountable to something. For me, I'm holding myself accountable to a small audience of people who really enjoy the videos that I'm making because I feel like I'm either informing them or sparking a discourse. That makes me feel good. It makes me feel like I'm part of something. And I believe full-heartedly that anybody in any community can find an opportunity to participate in something safely, distantly, digitally, however they need to. And having a sense of community, even if it's digital, is so important to the heart. We are social creatures. We need to honor that.
A big thanks to Ryan McCartan. You can follow him on social media. Just search for Ryan McCartan. And also, just a little note, we taped that interview several days ago. And immediately, soon after our interview, the news came down that Disney was canceling Frozen on Broadway for good. And just devastating news for Ryan, the entire cast, the crew of Disney's Frozen on Broadway. But I know Ryan will persevere, and this will not be the last time that Ryan is on Broadway. So we wish Ryan and the whole cast and crew of Disney's Frozen on Broadway, the very best. And again, you can follow Ryan on social media. We're going to take a break, everyone. Stay right there, back right after this.